The average person has a vague idea where the pelvis or the abdomen are, for example. The same cannot be said for another body cavity, the mediastinum. The mediastinum is the space between our lungs. Whoa, I thought my heart was between my lungs. Exactly. Your car is in the garage, your clothes are in the wardrobe, your heart's in the mediastinum. Precisely because the heart is so prominent in the mediastinum, this cavity is divided roughly according to where everything is in relation to the heart, or rather, to the pericardial sac. But the heart is inside the pericardial sac, so in the end it's pretty much the same thing. If you are above the heart, or above the pericardial sac, you are in the superior mediastinum. However, the traditional classification is based on lateral chest radiography. So saying just above the pericardial sac is not very precise. It would be better if we could have some easy to locate bony landmarks. So, the superior mediastinum is rather defined as a mediastinum that's posterior to the manubrium of the sternum, or the portion of the mediastinal cavity that's above the horizontal plane between the angle of the sternum, or the sternal angle, and the body of the fourth thoracic vertebrae. There, in the superior mediastinum, we find the superior portion of the thymus, the great arteries and veins, the trachea, the esophagus, and the vagus and phrenic nerves, as well as the thoracic duct. Either fortunately or unfortunately, depending on how you want to look at it, because there are so many structures on different planes in the superior mediastinum, it becomes important to know what's the relationship between them, meaning what's in front of which. If you open someone's chest and start digging, what are you going to find first and what are you going to find last? From anterior to posterior, or from superficial to deep, you first meet the glandular plane, where you will find the thymus in a child or just fat in an adult. Then, the venous plane, behind the thymus you see the left brachiocephalic vein, the right brachiocephalic vein, the superior vena cava, and the arch of the aesiguous vein. Delving deeper, you will then meet the arteries and the nerves in the arterial nervous plane, with the aortic arch and its branches, the brachiocephalic artery, the left common carotid artery, and the left subclavian artery, and also, laterally, the nerves, the left and right vagus nerves, and, more laterally, the left and right phrenic nerves. The fourth plane will then be the visceral one, and will include the trachea in front of the esophagus, as well as the left recurrent laryngeal nerve, and right before the vertebrae, you'll meet the last, the lymphatic plane, containing the thoracic duct, before it drains into the junction of the left internal jugular and subclavian veins. You may find slightly different classifications, but in the end, some things make quite a lot of sense. After all, the thymus is also present in the anterior mediastinum, which is in front of the middle mediastinum, and therefore, if it continues upwards, it makes all the sense that it would be the first, the formal structure in the anterior portion of the superior mediastinum as well. It was anterior downwards, it continues anterior upwards. In the same way, the trachea and the esophagus are going downwards, in the case of the esophagus, down to the abdomen, meaning they will continue from the superior mediastinum into the posterior mediastinum. They come straight from the neck and they are going down, so they will be behind the heart, and therefore, if they are going through the posterior mediastinum, it also makes sense that they would be pretty posterior also in the superior mediastinum, in one of the posterior planes. The trachea is obviously in front of the esophagus, otherwise we wouldn't be able to perform a tracheostomy or a cricothyrotomy, so the trachea has to be anterior to the esophagus. And since the aorta is going posteriorly to descend into the abdomen behind the heart, it also makes sense that the arteries should be posterior to the veins. After all, the aorta is also present in the posterior mediastinum. So in the end, it all pretty much makes sense. The thymus is the only content of the anterior mediastinum, and therefore is also anterior in the superior mediastinum. The veins are in front of the arteries, which makes sense since the aorta is posterior, and the trachea is anterior to the esophagus, otherwise we wouldn't be able to perform a tracheostomy. Now, the interesting thing about memorizing the superior mediastinum is that automatically we already know what we are expecting to find in the compartments of the inferior mediastinum, the continuing structures. So, in the anterior mediastinum, we will find the inferior portion of the thymus, between the sternum and the anterior pericardium, in front of the heart, and in the posterior mediastinum, between the posterior pericardium and the T5 to T12 thoracic vertebrae, we will find the thoracic portion of the descending aorta, as well as some of its branches, the bronchial, the esophageal, and the posterior intercostal arteries, the esophagus, immediately posterior to the left atrium, the esophagus vein, draining superiorly towards the superior vena cava, and the thoracic duct, also draining upwards between the thoracic aorta and the esophagus vein. Pretty much everything that's going to or coming from the abdomen. And then we have the obvious middle mediastinum containing the pericardial sac with the heart inside it, as well as the aortic root, the pulmonary trunk and arteries, and the phrenic nerves. In fact, the continuation of structures between the superior and the inferior mediastinum, such as the thymus, which is present both in the superior and in the anterior mediastinum, and the esophagus and the trachea, which are present both in the superior and the posterior mediastinum, is so significant that this is in fact one of the greatest criticisms to the four-compartment model of the mediastinum. It could be claimed that the division between superior and inferior mediastina is arbitrary, since there is no structure between these two chambers. And many diseases such as malignancies could easily spread from one to another. That's why, for example, the International Thymic Malignancy Interest Group prefers a three-compartment division of the mediastinum into prevascular, visceral, and paravertebral chambers, which inadvertently explains precisely why we want to divide the mediastinum. If one of the greatest criticisms to the four-compartment model is the fact that malignancies could spread between the compartments, for example, this shows to us that the complete purpose of dividing the mediastinum, aside, obviously, from orientating a surgery, is to easily identify what's the most likely pathology according to its location. When informed about a mediastinal widening, for example, a typical X-ray finding, where the mediastinum is wider than 6 to 8 cm on a posterior anterior view, you may choose to proceed the investigation with a lateral radiograph or with a CT, and then if you find out that the mass is in the anterior mediastinum, you would most likely suspect a thymoma or a lymphoma as the cause of the mediastinal widening. If you found out it's in the middle mediastinum, you might suspect a cardiac tamponade, for example. And if it's in the posterior or superior mediastinum, you might suspect a dissecting aortic aneurysm. Of course, there are many other possible causes, such as sarcoidosis, for example. But overall, this division between compartments aims to make it easier to predict the etiology of masses and abnormalities according to their location. To the extent that the anterior superior mediastinum, that is, the anterior mediastinum and the superior mediastinum, where most of the masses occur, has a serious contender for the worst mnemonic ever devised in medicine, where you could say that the anterior superior mediastinum is afflicted by the five T's: thymus, thymomas, thyroid masses, that is, goiter, mediastinal goiter, thoracic aorta, hereby referring to an aneurysm, teratoma, as well as other germ cell tumors, but mostly teratomas, and, wait for it, terrible lymphoma. Who created this? But if you feel distressed by this mnemonic, rest assured it could be way worse, because in Portuguese, I've heard it phrased as the five T's: thymoma, teratoma, terrible lymphoma, and tenebrous aneurysm. So yes, there's no mnemonic that cannot be made worse. But with this story, I hope you at least remember which are the five T's that we find in the anterior superior mediastinum. In general, the only thing consensual about the mediastinum is that it's bound inferiorly by the diaphragm, laterally by the parietal pleura, anteriorly by the posterior border of the sternum, posteriorly by the posterior margin of the chest wall, along with the transverse processes of the thoracic vertebrae, and superiorly by the thoracic outlet, thoracic inlet, or superior thoracic aperture through which it connects with the neck. The divisions may be sometimes a bit arbitrary, but the important thing is to know what's in front of what or behind what. Thank you for watching this video. Please bear in mind that this is not meant as medical advice. Check your physician or the latest protocol for that. If you've liked this video, please consider checking my playlists on medical review. Thank you for choosing to spend your time with me, and I hope to see you on the next video.